गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन, ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ गौर मोहन सचिन मंडल महाविद्यालय आई वेलकम यू ऑल टू टुडेज वेबिनार ऑन ई रिसोर्स एफिकेसी अ टूल फॉर टीचिंग लर्निंग एंड रिसर्च ऑर्गेनाइज्ड बाय द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ लाइब्रेरी इन कोलैबोरेशन विद आईपीएससी ऑफ आवर कॉलेज. वी फील प्राउड टू अनाउंस दैट टुडे वी हैव टू एमिनेंट रिसोर्स पर्सन विद अस टू शेयर देयर थॉट्स एंड एक्सपीरियंसेस regarding effective use of e-resources, its tools and techniques in academia. But before commencing the technical session, I would like to request our Honorable Bursar Sir and Associate Professor, Department of Commerce, Dr. Tapush Kumar Pal, to deliver his inaugural address. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Shivli. Respected President, sir, Sri Joydev Haldar, respected principal sir Dr. Abdullah Jamadar Hashan, governing body members, honorable resource persons, all the teachers of Gourmand Sachin Mandal Mahavidyalaya and other colleges, my dear students and other participants, good morning to all and welcome to today's webinar hosted by the library of the college in association with IQAC on the topic e-resource efficacy, a tool for teaching, learning, and research. The digitization of information in print media has brought a new concept altogether in all the fields of human life, and this has marked the beginning of information era. An electronic resource requires computer access of any electronic product and delivers a collection of data, be it referring to full text basis, electronic journals, image collections, other multimedia products. These may be delivered on CD-ROM, on tape, via internet, and so on. These are more useful due to inherent capabilities for manipulation and searching. Providing information access is cheaper to acquiring information resources, saving in storage and maintenance, etc. And sometimes the electronic form is the only alternative. The developments in scientific publishing and pricing policy of publishers posed new challenges and opportunities for academic libraries for purchasing and managing the serials within their restricted budget. The library and information activities of the 21st century are fast changing with the rapid development of electronic publishing. Libraries are not only acquiring reading materials such as printed books and journals, but also arranging for providing access to various learning resources in electronic form. The web resources and the use of web as a tool is changing the way users live and learn. While in the early phase, the World Wide Web was mainly used to push type applications to provide information and resources to users. The general content, the development of Web 2.0 and the spread of open sources and shared use concept have focused on other generated content and application for sharing. This has led to the rapid development and popularity of electronic resources. E-resources are occupying a significant portion of the global literature. They refer to information sources in electronic form. The different types of e-resources are e-books, e-journals, databases, CDs, DVDs, e-conference proceedings, e-reports, e-maps, e-pictures, photographs, e-manuscripts, e-theses, e-newspaper, internet websites, listservs, news groups, subject gateways, Usenet, FAQ, etc. These may be delivered on CD-ROM, DVD, over the internet, and so on. Providing access to e-resources is a service to help library users to find e-databases, e-journals, e-magazines, e-books, e-audio, e-images, data, GIS, digital library projects, electronic exhibitions, e-subject guide, e-newspapers, e-conference proceedings, and web search tool on a range of topics. The electronic books are helpful because of their easy portability, and its feature of incorporating more than one book in a single handheld device. The published materials are also available on open access platform. This helps the poorer also to get the information required free of cost and bridge the digital divide. They need not worry of licensing and usage of information. According to Dr. S.R. Ranganathan, in his fifth law, library is a growing organization. Library is not a store of books. It is a knowledge of center. Every reader visits the library with the intention to get the solution of his problem. Library should fulfill the needs of our community. So this is an excellent topic. I hope all of us must be enriched from the deliberations of two excellent experts in this field. I must thank to the librarian, Shivli Sengupta, and also to the IQSC coordinator, Professor Ranjini Guha, for arranging such a fantastic webinar. I must express my heartiest gratitude to Dr. Parthasarathy Mukhopadhyay, Professor, Department of Library and Information Science, University of Kulani, and Dr. Sushantu Banerjee, University Librarian, West Bengal State University. I wish a grand success of this webinar. Thank you all. Over to Shivli.
Thank you, sir, for your inspiring opening remarks. Now I would like to request our IQSC coordinator and associate professor, Department of History, Professor Ranjini Guha, to share her views. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, Shivli, and good morning to all. On behalf of GMSM Mahavidyalaya and Internal Quality Assurance Cell, I extend a warm welcome to our resource persons, Dr. Parthasarathy Mukhopadhyay and Dr. Sushantu Banerjee, two of the best minds in the field of library and information science in the state. My regards to our governing body president, Sri Joydev Haldar, and our principal, Dr. A.J. Hassan, for giving us the constant push towards quality improvements. A warm welcome to all the participants attending this webinar. Today is World Literacy Day, and libraries have a very important role in spreading literacy. There cannot be a better day to host a webinar on the efficacy of e-resources in today's world. A library is the best resource, in fact, to save people from the deluge of misinformation in these times of pandemic. More than 300 million students worldwide are having their education disrupted due to COVID-19. In these uncertain times, it is important that learning continues, even if it's virtual and not in person. Digital libraries can ensure continuity as COVID-19 puts a break to the normal academic activity. Transition to distance learning is the only option. Institutes are racing to shift their courses online. Students are engaging more and more with e-books and e-learning, and researchers drawing on e-journals. UNESCO has launched the Global Education Coalition to help countries scale up their best distance learning portals. Digital libraries have emerged as vital pathways in which quality e-books and educational content can be accessed. We are also convinced that access to knowledge cannot by itself act as a leveler. Inclusive knowledge societies are built only when equal access is enjoyed by one and all. Located in a rural college, we feel the need of such equal access more and more. Indian e-libraries and Indian digital library platforms are also undertaking to develop disability-friendly technologies. Through this webinar, we seek to promote safe, inclusive, and effective learning environment for all. Thank you once again. Do keep tuned to our YouTube channel, GMSM Media, for a host of interesting webinars. Tomorrow, we have a doyen of women's studies, Professor Rekha Pandey from the University of Hyderabad, where she will tell us why gender matters. Do tune in tomorrow at 11 a.m. and all the best to the program. Thank you, Shivli.
Thank you, madam, for your insightful remarks. Now let us start the session. For this, I would like to request Mrs. Anupama Moitra, Assistant Professor, Department of English, and our academic in charge to introduce us with our first resource person. Over to you, madam.
I wish everyone a very good morning. And it is my honor today to introduce the first speaker for the day. Professor Partho Sarathy Mukhopadhyay is a professor in Library and Information Science and former head Department of Library and Information Science, Kollayanu University. Professor Mukhopadhyay, a recipient of Best Young LIS Teacher Award, IASLIC, is an open source enthusiast and worked as a developer and promoter of many open source projects. He has more than 100 papers in journals and conference volumes and 5 books in the pipeline. His recent book on interoperability and retrieval is published by UNESCO Paris. Professor Mukhopadhyay acted as a metadata consultant for the project NDL, National Digital Library, hosted by IIT Kharagpur. He is presently a member of the Advisory Committee for National Virtual Library Project of the Ministry of Culture, Government of India. He developed Vidya Online, an e-learning portal for Vidyasagar University in 2006, and presently running 3 online courses in Swayam platform. I wish to thank Professor Mukhopadhyay for taking time out from his busy schedule and addressing our webinar. Over to you, Professor Mukhopadhyay.
Thank you, madam, for all the kind words. So in this particular webinar, as the topic says that, and madam, IQAC in charge madam nicely explained that that internet is playing a level playing factor for us, be it a remotely located college or be a university in the metro cities. All are now almost in the same platform. They can access same set of information, quality set of information from the same platform. Previously, that kind of opportunity was not there with us. Now, in this particular backdrop, I have selected my topic as Research 2.0, how we can utilize even in a remote setup, even in this particular pandemic situation, you are not connected to your libraries. So how you can supplement your information needs, information requirements through different kind of quality open access resources, and how can you utilize different open source activities, open source application in accessing those resources in a convenient manner. So let us go for it. Let me give a few seconds to share my screen, then I'll be coming. And meanwhile, I am stopping my camera because I am hibernating in a remote corner of Bengal, and my network connectivity is not as good as yours in a metro city. So meanwhile, during my presentation, I will keep my video up so that it won't disturb the on streaming of the presentation. Thank you all. Can you see my screen?
Sir, yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So this is the topic I have selected for you, Research 2.0, use of open access resources and open source tool. And before starting, I would like to extend my thanks to the organizing committee for keeping education on in the form of webinar and other things. And I came to that you are running a series of open webinar on different topics. That's a great thing. Okay. So research of any kind, I don't mean by the way, I don't mean here that your doctoral dissertation. Research of every kind, when you are giving an assignment to your student, when you are exploring new facets for your teaching learning evaluation purposes, all come under the part research. So research of any kind starts with existing piece of information and ends with the new information. I do you are, there are many definitions of research, but that is one particular point of view related to research. And you are, you know, you all agree with this particular view that every research starts with an existing piece of information and ends up with a new piece of information. So novelty is the objective of research, and research in broader sense related to every activities of teaching, learning, and evaluation. So if on the basis of this particular proposition, you know, right from your school days to till in a teaching career, you have encountered only three kind of information sources. So because you know that information sources is a very important thing for. You all can see, na? Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So the moment you don't see it, please inform me, because there I am not getting any kind of indication that whether I am out or in.
Oh.
Anyway. So,
okay, sir.
Shivli, you please take the responsibility to intimate me the moment it kicks me out. Okay.
Okay, sir.
As I said that research of any kind actually right from your school days to till in the teaching career, you believe me or not, this is a very true fact. We all library professionals know it, that there are three kind of information sources you have encountered. Primary sources of information, where you can find the latest research information, novel information, first hand research information. Then these are all compiled into the secondary sources, like say for example one journal, an instance of a journal, then your PhD thesis, all are comes under the purview of the primary information information sources. Then these are getting consolidated into secondary sources, and both secondary and primary sources are listed in the tertiary sources. So information flows from the primary to secondary to tertiary. But on the contrary, your search should be based on or should start from this point, tertiary to secondary to primary. Let me give you one example. Suppose there are many science stream in your college. So let us take the example of the domain of chemistry. In chemistry domain alone, there are 10,000 primary journals available. Now journals, you all know, comes under one volume per year. One volume includes many issues and one issue includes many articles. So on an average, if every journal has got 10 issues per annum and each issue contains 10 articles per issue, then you see at the end of the day, 10,000 chemistry journals actually producing 1 lakh of paper. And if you want to go for a comprehensive search on any given topic in the domain of chemistry, after 10 years, you are having 10 lakhs of journal articles. So how to find out your relevant 4 or 5 relevant papers against your query from the jungle of 10 lakhs of papers. So there comes the need of the secondary information sources like abstracting surveys, indexing surveys, electronic databases, etc. Now, how to know what are the secondary information sources, abstracting journal, indexing journal, review journals available in my domain? So there comes the tertiary source. So and be it print domain or be it online domain, this particular model provided by or given by Dennis Gogan way back in 1950 still holds true, because when you are searching Google, so that is there also you are following the same model, tertiary to secondary to primary. Google search engine is a tertiary source. It includes websites. Websites are secondary sources. Within the websites, there are different primary documents, your college notification, admission notice, and many other things. Those may be considered as a primary document. So here also you are using Google or any kind of search engine to go to the secondary, from secondary to primary. So that is the approach you need to take when we are trying to find out some information where presently my librarian, my library professionals are not there to help me because of this pandemic situation. We need to understand this. Now, as I said, that this is the situation, how these are getting consolidated and listed. So these are all primary sources, journals, research report, conference proceeding, patent standards, etc. These are getting consolidated and condensed in indexing, abstracting, reviews, etc. And great thing to know that your monographs and textbooks you are utilizing for your education purpose, for your teaching learning purposes, are not primary sources of information. These are secondary sources of information, because no textbooks provides you the first hand research information. These are basically provides you a systematic exposition to the knowledge based on the research reported in different kind of primary sources. Then how to know how many journals and secondary services available in my domain? So there are lot many tertiary sources that we need to consult. And as I said, that most of the large scale textual databases are also tertiary sources, and thereby, and by following that particular model, we access those resources. And as a researcher, as an academia, you have basically four approaches in mind. Either you are searching information for your current need. Say, for example, you are a teacher of geography. You know what is the subject, but you want to know what happened in my area of interest in the last 7 days, in the last 15 days, in the last 30 days. That is called the current approach. I am an expert. I know the subject domain, but I want to know what happened in my domain for the last 7 days. So that will help you to keep abreast with the ongoing changes. So that is one thing. Now, next one is the everyday approach. In some cases, some professions actually requires to have a standard data sets before start their job. For example, a financial analyst in share market, before starting his or her job of the day's job, he or she has to know what are the different kind of financial profiles of different companies and many other things. So this is also related to a data scientist, to a nuclear scientist, to a chemist, that before entering into lab, this is the set of information I need to have ready in hand. So that is called everyday approach. Now the third one is the exhaustive approach. Every time you are searching your Google for any odd keyword, you are making an exhaustive search. I want to know everything against this specific query. That is called exhaustive search. And the last one is the coming up rapidly present in the present day situation. That is called catching up approach. Because of the multidisciplinary nature of the research, interdisciplinary nature of the research, sometimes suppose you are a teacher of chemistry, but you are doing something some research on biochemistry. So quickly you need to understand what are the different fundamental facets related with the biology. So you are an expert of a domain, but layman in other domain. So how to catch up quickly the skills and the primary information, primary fundamental principles of that discipline. So there are a different kind of information resources that we called advances and different kind of reviews, etc. Those are called catching up approach. I want to know very quickly basic facts related to the other domain. So at the end of the day, it's a perfect matrix. You see, there are three kind of sources and four kind of approaches to information. So every information you are seeking, right from your school days to your research days, now as a teacher, you are all you can categorize all this into four only groups. And every time your information demand is satisfied, those are actually supported by either primary, secondary, or tertiary sources. So that is the theoretical backdrop before entering into the practical demonstration. But for the last 5-10 years, things are changing rapidly. So first important factor, or four fundamental facets or factors, are changing the way we interact with our resources, the way we interact with our students, our colleagues, etc. So these four factors are responsible.
first two is basically the ingredients. One is called the open and distributed information system, otherwise we call colloquially as internet. Then the entire internet is based on open source software and open standards. So these are actually acting as an ingredients. For example, this particular web conference, you are using StreamYard, and most of the participants are accessing through their web browsers like Firefox, Google Chrome, etc. So these are all open source software actually. Now, on the top of these two beautiful products are coming as a academia we are concerned with. One is the open access publishing system, another is the open learning system. So these two products are very much relevant for our day-to-day research activities. And before entering or before making a quantum jump into the topic, let me start with one of my most favorite quote given by Samuel Johnson. He was a lexicographer, as you know. So he said that knowledge has two facets basically. One facet is the what is the knowledge, and the other facet is where is the knowledge. I am no person to tell you what is the knowledge, because you all are subject expert, domain expert. But I am here to give you some of my personal experience to the other facet of the knowledge, that is, where is the knowledge? And you better know, in this age of internet, if you cannot mix up these two cycle, these two facets, then your knowledge cycle never completes. What is the knowledge and where is the knowledge? So second facet we are going to emphasize in today's 40-50 minutes odd lecture. So I will be starting open knowledge movement. Before starting, we need to know that what is called open knowledge object. So open knowledge object can be anything. It can be a set of data. It can be content like journal paper, thesis, report, book chapters. It can be government information, etc. But subject to the condition, it is available or published through open submission process, open peer review process. Peer review, you all know, when you submit a journal paper for publication, that goes through expert opinion, editorial board, that is called peer review, and open access without any discrimination. So that means anyone can access that particular knowledge object without any condition, without any fees, without any kind of socio-legal, socio-technical restrictions. So this is the concept of open knowledge. And let me gradually expose before you that how this concept is changing the entire, academic process. So knowledge is open if it is free to use, reuse, and redistribute. That means, if I am publishing a particular paper that anyone can download, anyone can distribute to his or her friends, so knowledge flows free. That is the concept of open knowledge, and without any legal, social, and technological restrictions. So that is the concept. And four pillars are working. Now, the thing is that if I ask you that how do you find information? Suppose in your teaching or research you need a new piece of information or a new concept you need to encounter, then what kind of information sources you are accessing? So most of the cases you will be telling me that we all use Google. Okay, fine. Google is your most favorite search engine. But after this class, Google won't be your most favorite search engine, that I'm sure. But there are many other web search tools available. Subject directories are available. Meta search engines are available. But we normally jump to Google, as for most of us, Google is the most visited cyberspace. We make a keyword search kind of thing and happy what is happening in the first two sets. So normally, if we go side by side demonstration mode also. So normally we people go for this kind of access. So I'm going to Google. So this is your most favorite search engine, and let me tell you the mistakes we are doing. So this I am increasing the size slightly. Now suppose I am searching by a topic, everybody understand, environmental pollution, and Google actually given me the data. So you can see that this is the environmental pollution, and Google given me 28 crores 70 lakhs
types of document. You imagine that Google cannot access documents. Say, I want to access documents written by Amartya Sen. Google cannot do that. I want to have environmental pollution as a subject. Google cannot do that. But when I search or simple keyword basis search, Google can work finely and given me 28 crores, 70 lakhs of document. Now tell me, in my lifetime, is it possible to go through this all 28 crores, 70 lakhs of document? We saw normally what we do, each of us. So Google gives data in different sets. It says a set contains 20 documents. Now we are happy with what comes in the first 2-3 sets. So if you go set beyond set number 4 or 5, then you will be getting lot many junks Google actually producing. So those are actually not related to your search. For example, if I search here by computer driver, beyond set number 4 or 5, Google will retrieve taxi driver, automobile driver association, even screwdriver, because the term driver is common. And Google has no intelligence to discriminate between the term driver in computer driver and the driver in screwdriver. So here, before entering into the details of open access, very quickly let me tell you how to search a large-scale textual search engine like Google. So do not search in this fashion. As I said that our bread and butter is information. We need to seek information for every second as a teacher, as a researcher. But normally we give no attention to learn the different kind of searching skill. So we spend hours and hours in front of our computer, in front of Google, and then you see we at the end of the day we almost have nothing in our hand, because we simply do not care about how to make a good search. Now this environmental pollution, if this particular area is my research area, so what I will do, this is the process. I will be explaining you later on, but you just remember, before making this advanced search, we have 28 crores, 70 lakhs of document. Now I am making some kind of search refinement, and you see the result. I will explain everything. Don't worry. I will be coming to this search query, but before that you see the result. If it shows some kind of improvement, then only your attention will be there. So in place of the simple environmental pollution, I have just changed the search sequence slightly, search syntax slightly, and now pressing my enter command. Now you see the result. You see the quantum improvement it made. Now it is saying me there are only 455 most relevant documents against your query. And now let me tell you that how I did it, how I reduced my search result from 28 crores 70 lakhs of document to only 455 most relevant document. And don't forget that environmental pollution is a very common term. So here also we get that kind of success. So from the entire globe, we searched and we collected our resources. Those are most relevant for my research. Now let me explain one by one. So here you see, first, in the first case, we use simple environmental pollution. But here in the second case, I am using environmental pollution as a phrase by giving double inverted quote. So there is a difference between the keyword searching and phrase searching. So the moment I enclose these two different keywords within a common, inverted comma, that is called a phrase search, that means I am instructing Google to retrieve only those documents where environmental and pollution, these two terms came side by side. So it became a phrase. Then I asked Google that, okay, this phrase now you search only in the title. Why? Because if my query phrase is available in the title itself, or the title of a document itself, then that definitely that is the most relevant resource for me. Suppose let me give you an example. Suppose there are three papers. In one paper, environmental pollution appeared in the title. In the next paper, it appeared in the abstract. And in the third paper, it appeared in the body of the paper, that is the body of the journal paper, the full text. So definitely you can understand that as a researcher, as a teacher, that if a particular phrase appeared in the title, then the core focus of that particular book chapter or journal paper or thesis must belong to the core group of my research. So I again instructed, this is called the special keywords in Google. All in title stands for that all the word, this multi-worded phrase must appear in the title in the sequence I have given. Then I have restricted the file type into PDF. So, you know, in internet there are many file types, HTML, DOC, PPT, etc. So most of the cases, academic resources are available either in PDF format or in DOC format, mostly in PDF format. So I have restricted again file type PDF. You restrict retrieve only those files which are having environmental pollution as a phrase in the title, and the file resource type is PDF. So PDF is an extension. Here you can give DOC, PPT, etc. Then I given the last and the final special keyword, site colon in. You retrieve everything from India. This dot in or IN stands for the domain name, CCTLD, country code top level domain for India. Each and every country actually represented by two alpha code. Say for example, BD for Bangladesh, PK for Pakistan, JP for Japan, IN for India. So this is the standard first developed by librarians for the cataloging purposes. Later on, ISO adapted it and renamed as ISO 3166. That ISO 3166 taken by the Sun Microsystem and started the present age domain name system. So there I can restrict my search in any countries in this way. If I exclude this particular filter, you see what happens. It now globally searching and the result is 5560. If I restrict my search to Bangladesh, BD, site colon BD, again you see the result will be less, only 5. Again, I can extend my search in the second level domain, say ac.in. Most of the college and universities are registered under the academic domain, that is called sub-level domain. AC stands for academic, ac.in. There also it will work. So 309 number of result. So instead of my first suggestion in this particular demonstration to my colleagues who are working there in this college and from colleagues from other college and universities, that do not search Google like a novice searcher. You are the expert of the domain. You need to know how to search. And I am not trying to jam your head. I know you are all busy with your subject domain, but little bit of, you know, basic knowledge of searching is required. And you see here, this is paying us. Instead of going through 28 crores of document, if I can restrict or if I can scheme up the most relevant documents against my query, then definitely I'm saving, you know, my active research time. In fact, there is an internet company called Pew Internet Research Group. They came up recently with a very interesting research finding that 80% of our active research time is actually going, as we are spending for, you know, different kind of searching alone. So you can save that, you know, pain, that, you know, unnecessary wastage of time, and can put back that particular time and effort in your actual research. So these four keywords you can utilize. And here you see, I can also change my extension here. So I'm giving PPT. And now I'm deleting this particular filter. So now it will retrieve all, you know, four results are there. And all are PPT. All are PPT file. So you don't have to, you know, worry about the correctness of the search. This we, you know, experienced a lot. So these are the four special keywords. The first search by phrase, inverted quote, then all in title as a phrase. And you please remember that there will be no space before colon and no space after colon, and all will be in lowercase. So this is the first lesson I'm going to tell you. Now I'm coming back again to my presentation. Now you see here that we already completed the web search, but the problem of the web is that you know now little bit that you know how different kind of search can be conducted and pinpointedly, but even after knowing little bit of searching, you will find that the end of the day, most of the documents are required documents you have retrieved by using Google or any other search engine, half of them are actually under copyright. So what is happening? This is my experience. I am quite sure that your experiences will also be matching with me. So as a result, what is happening? Academicians suffers a lot in India and other developing blocks of this uneven world, because in our libraries they are not having that kind of budget so that they can brought everything for us. They cannot buy everything for us. So there is coming a concept in place of the copyright that is called copyleft, and that copyleft licensing system powered by different kind of Creative Commons licensing are actually helping us in the research process. So in the next demonstration process, I will show you that at the end of this deliberation, you will be getting 250 million quality open access resources free of cost. Either you can utilize personally or you can utilize inside your library system. So that is my point. But before that, let me tell you that the entire open access movement took a sharp turn recently. So now, just like the freedom struggle of India, if you go through in details, then the one major group is under Mahatma Gandhi. We followed their non-violence, non-cooperation, satyagraha, etc., an attempt to gain freedom through discussions and many other things. But the another group is the basically extremist group, led by Bhagat Singh, Khudiram, Subhash Chandra Bose. They believed that British government won't be considering that kind of non-cooperation and long-term process. So let us fight it back. Now, in open access also, there are two philosophies. One is the mainstream open access or legal open access. They believed in the Gandhian philosophy. They believe in the discussion, different kind of non-cooperation, different kind of legal battles, and they are actually gaining momentum. So other group started by Aaron Swartz way back in 2010, and later on, led by Alexander Albakine. The picture you can see. Alexander Albakine declared as the Lady of the Year by the Nature Group of Publishers in the year 2016. That is called guerrilla open access system. So they are actually looting publishers. They developed a system by utilizing different login password and different other kinds of protocol. They are systematically downloading everything from the publisher's website and provided that particular document set free of cost to the other researchers. So Alexander Albakine is considered as the Robin Hood of science. But today, in today's lecture, I am not talking about Alexandra. I am not talking about guerrilla open access. I'm concentrating on the mainstream open access, which is actually completely legal, completely, socially accepted. So open access supports actually the facilitates to find research very fast, faster and easier, and they integrate everything in the same place. Now, why open access? In a developing country like ours, every taxpayer pay money for our research. When we are doing some kind of lab-based research, some kind of DEX research, everything is supported by our countrymen. Now, the moment we got something good, we tend to publish our paper in foreign journals, and we give away our copyright to the foreign publishers. Licensing is very complex and restrictive. We are simpleton teacher. We do not know legalities. We simply sign without reading. So what is happening? My research is funded publicly by the government of India. Government of India is running on the top of taxpayers' money. And I give my entire copyright to the foreign publisher. And my library is again paying to that foreign publisher to buy the periodical. So for every research, government of India is paying twice. First, they're funding us to do the research. Then we publish our research findings in foreign journals. Again, our libraries, which are again running in public monies, 95% of libraries in India are actually running on taxpayers' money. They are basically procuring those journals. So that is happening. It's called double-edged payment system. So why this double-edged payment system started and when it started? So first scholarly journal published, you know, in the year 1665, journal The Scavens from the Royal Society of Philosophy. Then 1675, peer review process introduced that everything authors submit won't be published. So that they will be going through different kind of quality checking. That process is called peer review. But 17th century to till date, we are following the same age-old subscription-based peer review journal system. Many things changed in the world. Almost everything changed. Value system changed. In the age of Netflix, in the age of Amazon Prime, we are still following the age-old subscription-based peer review journal system, which is not anymore commercially viable. So that is one thing. Another thing, you know, a lot many other things also happened. We started with the handwritten manuscript, gone through the printed technology revolution in 1465, and presently, after the decade of 90, in the 20th century, we all started to moving towards the digital only world, or digital revolution already started setting. And there you can see the number of print journals actually reducing every day. First online journal appeared four to five in number in 1996. Within 4 years, it outnumbered print journals, and you see the situation now. Online journals are, new online journals are now every year published 3,000 to 5,000, and print journal reduced to 4 to 5. So the ball game has completely changed. The paradigm shift already happened. And in a university or college, how do we access? In university, we have UGC InfoNet. This is an example from Burdwan University. Same thing is happening for every university, from my friend Sushanta's university also. And at the college level, you people are having Enlist. Enlist is a stripped down version of UGC InfoNet. If you pay membership to the InfoNet, then you will be getting access to 45,000 odd ebooks and 5,000 plus e-journals, and the list is increasing every day. But please remember that at the college level, at the university level, you are getting it free. That does not mean it is free actually. Government of India, Ministry of HRD is paying a huge sum of money to the publisher to procure this kind of material. So still the problem remains. Now, if we come into the core problem of this particular situation, here you see, you people are doing research, academic, research, scientist, etc. You write paper, manuscript, send to the peer review process to the editorial board. They are very tough people. 2-3 times they will send back your paper. You need to modify. And then finally, your paper published in a high impact factor commercial journal like this one, Elsevier journal. Now, have you ever thought what happened to your paper? Your paper actually came to the library. And one fine morning, these are all bounded volumes. One fine morning, one researcher working in your area or domain again picked up your research paper. He or she conducted their own field-based research, lab-based research, again published a manuscript, and so on. So this process actually continues. This, like any other natural cycle, like carbon cycle, nitrogen cycle, this is also called information transfer cycle. We consume information because we want to contribute information. So information consumption leads to information contribution. So this information transfer cycle is true and valid for every area of research. But you all know that many of you having PhD degree, doctoral degree, many of you are acting as a PhD guide. Then what is the new thing in here? What I try to mean here, there is a problem. There is a serious problem in this particular information transfer cycle. If you take into account the base year as 1986 up to 2002, this is a research conducted by a Harvard University professor. Journal price increase in the top bar, you can see the red bar, increased in the tune of plus 222% during the period from 86 to 2002. 222% increase. This is exorbitant increase in the price. Now, how can you tell, how I am telling you that it's an exorbitant and high price rise? Why? Because during this period, if you calculate globally the consumer price index, CPI, it increased in the tune of plus 64 only. So why journal is actually that kind of costly device, nobody knows. Because when you are writing a paper to a journal, a commercial journal, do they pay you? No.
when you reviewing a particular paper for a journal, do they pay us? No. Do they pay our senior colleagues for, you know, performing the activities related to different activities or responsibilities of editorial board? No. Then they are procuring raw materials free of cost. They are processing it in the form of journals, either e-format or print format, and selling in an exorbitant price. Nobody knows why. Because have you ever heard that a Elsevier, a publisher, the greatest, you know, biggest publisher in the domain of science and technology, funded any research anywhere in the world? No. They do not back contribution to the research. They do not support any kind of social development process. They are snatching money like anything. And you are burning your midnight oil. You are, on the basis of your intellectual labor, they are making huge, huge, financial resources. Because every year, Elsevier goes through, if you go through the annual report of Elsevier, constantly they are getting 37% net profit. And now tell me, in this age of recession, what business gives you 37% net profit? Even the most, lucrative business of the world, the oil industry, they also earn only 17 to 18% of the net profit. But these publishers earn 37% of the net profit because they are not paying back to the contributors. They are not paying back to the society. They are only making money. So that is the situation. That is the wrong thing happening in our domain. We are all acting as a bonded labor for this publishing professional. And we fight and compete with each other to give our intellectual labor free of cost to them. And which particularly my countrymen, my citizen, my fellow citizen, my government supported. So that is the situation. That is the wrong thing happening. Now, is it the end because of this open access movement? Have publishers stopped anything? No. If you again take 1986 to 2010, journal price increased in the tune of plus 400%. Again, if you come to the another up to 2014, we calculated journal price increased in the tune of 521%. So it's go on increasing, and I doubt that by 2025, if you compare from the 86 as the base year, most of the financial calculation done on the basis of 1986 as the base year, so it will go up to 1,000 time increase in the journal price. So this is the situation. So as a result, what is happening? You people are writing paper, your colleagues are editing it, your senior colleagues are reviewing it, but you don't have access to journals. That is the situation globally, and this is called serial crisis. We write papers, we don't have right to read that paper, because my library cannot subscribe that, because my library budget is not increasing in the tune of plus 200% every year. Sushanto can tell you better. In fact, one particular study shows that library budget is sinking all over the world. For the last 5 years, it's actually reduced to 30%. So I'll be giving you that set of data also. So as a result, what is happening, journal industry is a perfect example of oligopoly. That means few players are actually determining the, if you go to the science and technology, it is Elsevier. If you go to the material science, Kluwer. If you go to the biomedical literature, Chapman and Hall. So these five, six companies tied their hand together. They have hidden agreement. Elsevier never published a journal in the domain of, mathematics. Similarly, John Wiley never published a journal in the domain of chemistry. So they have hidden agreement and they are looting people. So this is the situation. So against this particular backdrop, open access is coming in a big way. Open access philosophy I already explained before you. Now let me tell you some of the tools that can help you to gain access to different kind of openly available resources. So again, I am going to the demonstration mode. You can. I do hope you are. You are getting my screen here. Browser screen. Can someone please respond? Can you see the my browser screen?
Yes, yes, we can see that.
Okay, fine. Thank you. So now I am going for giving you a set of open access resources that can help you. The first meta tool, that is, as I said, the tertiary tools are most important for us. So this is the first meta tool I am going to be presenting before you. This is developed by a university, Lund University, because universities are taking the lead role to compete now the publishers, because they know already Harvard University terminated their contract with Elsevier because of this kind of, you know, financial irregularities. So this is the journal site, doaj.org, doaj.org, directory of openaccessjournal.org. So here you are getting 15,000 plus journal and 52 lakhs of articles, free of cost. You can search by journal, you can search by article. And please remember, if a particular journal is listed in Doaj, then that means it's a quality journal. It needs to pass 25 quality parameters. So UGC is thinking to include all Doaj journals in the API list in the coming years. So give a due attention to the Doaj journal, both as a consumer of information as well as a contributor to information. So directory of open access journal. This is called the gold path of open access. People are writing their paper directly in an open access journal so that everyone can access their paper, everyone can read their paper. Because when you are writing a particular paper, you are not thinking of money. You don't expect that a person on the street will be clapping against your paper. What do you expect by writing a paper? The only reason we academia write a paper to get peer recognition. I want recognition from my peers who are working in the same domain, in the same research area. So that is the only purpose you have. Then third-party publishers came to exploit that kind of things, and they do not give anything back to the author or research as a whole, but making money. So this kind of things are coming. Not many open access journals are coming in different disciplines. But again, I said tertiary tools are most important thing. So this is one of the tertiary tools we are having in the journal domain. That is called the gold path of open access. Now, what is happening? Many of you already published your paper in different commercial journals, but you are legally in a position. There is a legal right that either the preprint version or the postprint version of your paper, you can upload in an open access repository. So how to know what are the open access repositories available in my domain? Say, for example, I am a researcher in the domain of education. How can I know how commercially published paper, authors uploaded into open access repository, distributed to, throughout the world? So I need a single place, a tertiary tools like Doaj to know how many repositories are there in my domain. So another university came up. This is called the green path of open access. That is called opendoor.org. Opendoor.org is actually started by University of Nottingham. University of Nottingham and UK-based institutes are actually collecting, just like Doaj is doing for open access journal, they are doing for open access repositories or the green path. That's why I'm saying repeatedly that always try to find out the tertiary tools in the domain of the research. So Doaj is a good tertiary tool, then comes the open door. Now here in the open door, suppose, as I said, that I am a researcher in education. So this is the site address. And don't worry about the site address. I will share my slide and I will give you a list of references, how to go through that. So this is actually, presently it is running by SERPA, another agency in UK, but it is started by University of Nottingham. So now if I click the advanced search button here, you'll see what happens. So it will be giving a list of subject references. And believe it or not, there lies the role of the library. So most of the cases, libraries of the world came up. This is called Library of Congress subject heading list. They categorized the entire domain of universe of knowledge into different subject domains and given us the list. Now let me select education, as I am a researcher of education. So you see here under social science, there are many groups. And there is no discrimination in open access between arts, humanities, social science and technology. If you go to the present commercially dominated publisher, they are slightly inclined towards the STEM group, science, technology, engineering and management. Now
In open access, you won't find any kind of distinction. You will be finding science, similarly social science, and so on. So I'm selecting education as my domain. The moment I click search button here, so all the repositories related to education throughout the world will be listed. And you see here 241. So if on an average, each of these 241 repositories includes 10,000 paper on an average on education, so you do your mathematics, 241 into 10,000 number of papers which are commercially published, otherwise not available, you are having against legally against Creative Commons licensing system. So in this way, you can go by repository to repository, or you can directly search it from here, this search button. So please explore OpenDoor as a tertiary tool in the domain of GreenPath. Now, another tertiary tools I'm telling you, global tertiary tool related to research. Sometimes your full text research is important, and you know our government already started, they have already started successfully completed, they are in the middle, that is called Shodh Ganga. It is the national thesis repository of our country. So similarly, there are many other countries with many other, you know, thesis repositories. For example, NDLTD is there for US, Ethos is there for UK, Thesis Common is there for European universities. So how to get a global tools where I can have all of my thesis, full text thesis in one place? So this is the next tertiary tool I'm going to tell you, oatd.org, open access thesis and dissertation.org. So here you can see, you can search all of the national thesis repositories all over the world from a single place. 30 million full text research thesis is available, and this is the open access symbol you can see developed by UNESCO. So anything I can search, say for example, here I search in Google environmental pollution. Now the same query I am making here in OATD for, you know, this environmental pollution. So you see what happens. So now this time I am not getting paper, not getting journal paper or book chapter. I am getting full text thesis at different level. You see in the left hand side how many filters are there, year wise, university wise, department wise, level wise. So I am interested in doctoral dissertation only. So I can click here. I am interested in English language only. I can click here. So in this way I can filter my research report. I can click it. I can have full success. 30 million thesis from one place. I promised you that after this lecture, you will be having 250 million quality open access resources right in your laptop without paying a single buck to anybody. So this is 30 million resources. Now another, as you are teaching in a undergraduate college, so textbook is a very important requirement for you. So a few sites are coming again, like DOAJ, Directory of Open Access Journal Book. There is a site coming up, DOA Books, Directory of Open Access Books. Just like your Directory of Open Access Journal, there is a Directory of Open Access Books. So doabooks.org. So it is now presently giving around 30,000 peer-reviewed books from different disciplines, but it is growing every day. Another one for those who are working in language and literature, for them, the most resourceful book can be available from HathiTrust. The term Hathi, they have, although it's a US-based initiative, but don't go by the term Hathi. The term Hathi they have taken from Indian language to indicate the, we call it the elephantal memories. So this is the elephantal memories of books of the world. Most of the classics books, out of the print books, you can have it from here. You can search like your library catalog. The moment you select catalog by author, by subject, etc. Or you can search in the full text also. So most of the books are available in open access domain. Many of the books you don't find in any of the libraries. Like first edition of Kapalkundala, we got it from here, HathiTrust. So for language and literature teachers, this is a mine of information. Another very good archive for old book is archive.org. after HathiTrust. So archive.org, you can see. Here also you can search our books and other things. Lot of, you know, age-old books, classic books, you can find it here, right from here, without any costing. Then one initiative I would like to tell you, openlibrary.org. As I said, the Aaron Swartz started the guerrilla open access movement. One of his contribution to develop this openlibrary.org, where this is it has got a tie up with HathiTrust and Internet Archive. You see, this Internet Archive logo is there. Now, they are giving you lot many copyright free books, as well as if a book is there but it is not available for downloading due to copyright restriction. So there you can do one thing. You can register yourself to openlibrary.org and you can borrow that book electronically for 14 days. So free of cost. There is no registration fee. So after reading, after 14 days, this will disappear from your library, your personal library in openlibrary.org. That is called personal search environment also. So this is again a very worth tool for trying for particularly college teachers. But if you are really interested to open educational resources in this pandemic situation, another great resource is oercommons.org. Now oercommons.org gives you label based, grade based, different kind of resources. It is presently supported by UNESCO also. This is the site address, oercommons.org. So it is taking a little bit of time, let it come. So meanwhile, let me go to the things. So far I discussed about DOAJ, OpenDoor, DOAP, OATD, everything. Now your one question is definitely coming to your mind. So where is the 250 million resources? Because 30 million and 25 million, this kind of data so far we got. Now, let me introduce the killer, search engine developed by a group of librarians from a university, BioLeflet Academic Search Engine. So this is developed by Central Library of BioLeflet University. You can see in the bottom part. So it contains, if you go through this particular site, it contains presently 242 million of academic resources from a single search interface. It includes your green path, your gold path, your thesis, your books, everything in a single place. One window search interface for every academic resources. And it's a very sophisticated search engine. For example, the same environmental pollution I'm searching, and this is the website address. base-search.net. Base stands for BioLeflet Academic Search Engine. BioLeflet is a university in Germany and its central library. I also part of this particular team because this is based on a open source software, ViewFind, of which I am a member of the developer group. So we are connected with this particular project. So in this particular project, let me search just like Google. You all know that this we made a search, and you just again imagine the display format of Google. You can search pinpointedly, but display or format is very wrong with Google. Until and unless I click this, I simply do not know whether this particular document is relevant for me or not. But here you see the search result of base, because there is a middle stack of librarian. Librarians know that how to provide you information, how to organize information. So this is the, I searched the entire document just like Google, environmental pollution, and you see here is the display format. If you go to the cross connection of the any of this display format, it tells you who is the author, who is the publisher, who is the content provider, whether this is open access or not, this particular symbol. You can email this, you can add to your favorite list, you can check the full text availability in Google Scholar, or if you click this title, it will give you the access to full text Scholar. Display format is excellent, and right from here you can take a decision whether you need to go to the full text or not. And there are many filters. Here you see, you can filter by author, you can filter by TDC number, class number in library science, you can filter by subject. As you know, environmental pollution is a multidisciplinary subject. So I can restrict my domain in toxicology, pollution, health, general medicine, and so on. Then document type, I can select article, text, report, thesis. So everything you are getting in the same interface. And how many? 242 million. What is 1 million? 10 lakhs of records. And you can also select here, I am interested only open access. So this is the situation. And any point of time, you can go for that one search at title. So for example, if I select title in environmental pollution in that as a page in the title, so you see the number of results will be reduced after searching. So it is now searching the phrase only in title, and you don't have to write the complex queries like Google. Now it is $5,000. I want to check author search. How many documents are there written by Amar Tosen? Just like a library. And Google, you cannot do by author search or subject search. Because if I search by Amar Tosen in Google, it will retrieve documents written by Amar Tosen. But at the same time, it will retrieve documents on Amar Tosen, document with a link to Amar Tosen, Wikipedia article on Amar Tosen, and so on. So here you see, I am doing Amar Tosen as an author search. So it will retrieve all documents available in the open access domain written by Amar Tosen, 2410 number of records. Now I can restrict my search in different form. So I want books, I want report, I want book chapter, and so on. So this way, 242 million resources you can enjoy through BASE, and thanks to the group of librarians, it's a global group who are providing a single search interface for everything. You can even browse or even you can search, so you can explore by yourself. Now meantime, this is the OER Common. What is the specialty in OER Common? You can search here for the say environmental pollution. I can select my subject, suppose applied science. I can select my educational level. So I am going for the graduate courses, college level, and the standard I want. Different kind of educational standard is there. If you are not quite sure, don't select anything. Now start. So what is the difference between OER Commons and other search tools? It is directly giving you a list of open educational resources related to environmental pollution. Because in this era of pandemic situation, sometimes we need direct educational resources. So I can now go for downloading different kind of tools given by the OER Commons. So this is one of the exporting devices, oercommons.org. Now, these are all resources. I kept my promise of 250 million resources. Now, that is the take that I can use for the commercial journal. For example, I am now in home quarantine process. So, I don't have any tools to go through a commercial portal like Science Direct. So, Science Direct, we subscribe in a university system, but this EZ proxy and other things we need for providing for home access. But let me tell you a very simple set of tools like CASA, Campus Activated Subscription, Access to Subscription. So that CASA we are utilizing, and I will show you. So for example, Science Direct, I am not a subscriber. So what is happening, you see, it's a commerce out and out commercial tool from Elsevier. And it's a very useful thing for the library professionals. They can introduce in their library. Say, so I'm searching by the same environmental pollution. Now what is happening? So this time, all the papers published in Science Direct, has got around 1200 journals. Now you see, it is telling me sign in on registration. I don't have that much of money to register in Science Direct, to pay Science Direct, because only a university can do that. Now you see, there are many articles. These are all articles available. Now, suppose this second article I am interested in. this I'm just selecting blindly. So second article, suppose you are interested to have the full text. If you click this particular full text, you see many of my stool actually started working. You see here in the left side here, one stool started working. Here one tool is telling me the situation. Here another tool is telling me or trying to related papers on this particular journal paper. So this kind of open access browser based tools we can utilize. So if a particular research paper, you know, see the code actually retake. Let me try a particular paper which is having access. Then you can add. So what I will tell you at the individual level in your Google Chrome browser, you can go for the way I am surviving here in my home quarantine, you know, process. Now here you see this full text paper, I don't have pay anything, but this particular option came for me that it is, are you interested the full text of this paper? And if I click here, it will lead me to the full text. It is called Campus Activated Subscription Access, CASA. So what I did, I just, because of this, my laptop, I normally take into my department, and in the department, when you are using the university network, so you are under that IP range. So Google can now remember your IP range, even if you are away from your library. And if a particular journal has got a full text access, it can provide you the full text access right from the home through this CASA. Now in the left, right hand side, you can see this is called Copernio. Copernio is an extension. If it finds any kind of PDF file from its repository, it can provide you access. Now this white button, you can see this is called open unpayworld.org. If any of the equivalent paper, if this particular paper either pipprint or postprint available in the open access domain, right from here it can tell me. And this is the core paper. It can identify the similar papers in the line of this paper. So these are the all Google Chrome extension, and you can have it. Now another, the last tool I can show you. So let me tell you that what are the tools I'm using. This is called Core extension. This is called unpayworld.org. This is called Semantic Citation or SI, and this is called Copernio. So all this you search, write out spelling. All you can have installed in your Google Chrome. Only compatible so far with the Google Chrome. So always go for the Google Chrome browser, and you can have all this kind of research support system ready for you, to support you. So the last things what I am going to tell you, that is now systems are there that can read on behalf of me. Say for example, I am again searching from Google Scholar. You all know this. If a particular document available in PDF format, now suppose this first document is a book, second one is from academia, I don't like much. This this is coming from OUP. Now if I open this PDF file in Google Scholar, this is available as open access. Now you see the whole 13-14 pages of that particular paper should appear, and this is the PDF file. Subject to the condition, you are opening this in a PDF format. So this is the PDF paper, and how many pages are there? 24 pages. Now you see I can call another tool called Scholar C, which can read on behalf of me. So this is my bookmark mark. So I called that particular tool. It started extracting this PDF format, and it will summarize the key points or magnets of the paper. So before reading this 24 pages of the document, I can decide that whether it is worth reading or not. So you see what it did. It identified the key concept related with the paper. So these are the key concepts. All these key concepts are related with their corresponding Wikipedia article. So indoor air pollution, health effect, global burden, disability adjusted life years, all are key concepts related to this topic. It can create highlights for me. So this is the Scholar C highlight. You see, the entire paper reduced into five magnetic magnets, five key points. So I would like to read this particular key points, then I will decide. And interestingly, it can list all the references here. So I can click the references, and within these references, how many of these are available in an article? So the silver. So it's got 10 references, and of which how many references available as in open access channel, that also it can tell me. So you see, these are all available free of cost as a research support system. You can yourself, you can equip yourself with a different kind of resources and open access research support tools like unpaywall.org, Semantic Citation, Copperneo, Scholar-C, etc. And everything available free of cost, like in your laptop. So that's all from my side. Thank you. That's all from my side. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your informative and enriching lecture. Is there any question? Hello? Hello, am I audible?
Yes, we can hear. Yes, we can hear you.
Thank you, sir, for addressing our queries, and we feel lucky to have you with us, sir. Now let us start our second session. For this, I would like to request Mrs. Priyali Das, Assistant Professor, Department of English, to introduce us with our next resource person. Over to you, madam.
Thank you, Shuli. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm extremely happy and honored to introduce the second speaker of our today's webinar, Dr. Sushanta Banerjee. Dr. Banerjee hails from a subdivisional town of North Bengal. He has completed his studies from DRTC, Indian Statistical Institute, Bangalore. He did his PhD from Punjab University, Chandigarh. He has been associated with many reputed organizations and has worked successfully over there. He was the founding director of the British Council in Chandigarh and was also the director of the American Library, American Consulate, Kolkata. In addition to that, we owe a great deal to Dr. Banerjee, as he was our IQSE external member for many years. He has helped us in our library automation. He has also helped us in setting American Library Corner in our college. He has received many national and international awards. Currently, he is the university librarian at West Bengal State University. Today, he is going to deliver his lecture on the topic titled E-Resource, Infrastructure, Source, and Usage from Indian Perspective. We are eager to listen to him. So a warm welcome, and over to Dr. Banerjee. Thank you. Over to you, sir.
Over to you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Das, for your kind words. I would also like to thank Shivli Sengupta, the librarian of the college, for inviting me to this webinar. I feel especially happy
Please unmute yourself.
Yeah, can you hear me now? Yeah, Shuri, can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you. Dr. Banerjee, could you begin from the beginning?
Yeah, can you hear me now? Hello?
Yes, we can hear you.
Sir, we can hear you.
Dr. Banerjee, we can hear you.
Can you hear me? Yeah.
Yeah, we can hear you.
Sorry. Thank you, Dr. Dash, for your kind words. I would also like to thank the librarian of the college, Shivli, for inviting me to this webinar. I feel especially happy that I am attending the program of a college where I am associated for almost a decade now. My sincere thanks to the principal and all the teaching and non-teaching staff of the college for giving me this opportunity. The topic of the webinar today is e-resources, a tool for teaching, learning, and research. As my topic says, I would like to be
concentrating my talks about the scenario in India, the infrastructure for providing e-resources, and also the e-resources provided by MHRD, UGC, and other organizations for the development of teaching, learning, and research. As you all are aware, that to control the spread of COVID-19, the central and state governments were forced to close most of the educational institutions from school to university level from the end of March. It is still difficult to predict when schools, colleges, and universities will reopen. And here it comes the importance of e-resources or e-learning, which we were not thinking the way we are thinking now, sometimes back also. Teachers and administrators have been advised to continue communication with the students through virtual lectures or portals like Massive Open Online Courses or MOOCs. However, in the absence of physical classrooms and proper digital infrastructure, both teachers and students are facing various challenges. The major challenge of remote learning is disparity in access from electricity and interest and internet connections to devices like computers or smartphones. Access to electricity is crucial for digital education, both for powering devices as well as for connecting to the internet. You all know, if we do not have power and we need to do some work in internet, how much problem we used to face in our day-to-day life. While the government's Shobhagya scheme to provide electricity to thousands of households shows that almost 99.9% of homes in India have a power connection. However, the ground reality is less luminous if we look at the quality of electricity and the number of hours for which it is available every day. Mission Antodaya, a nationwide survey of villages conducted by the Ministry of Rural Development in 2017-18, showed that 16% of India's household received, I point it out again, 16% of India's household received 1 to 8 hours of electricity daily. 1 to 8 hours of electricity daily, it is being received by 16% of Indian households. 33% received 9 to 12 hours, and only 47% received more than 12 hours a day. Now, while computer would be a preferable form for online classes, the main tools of online classes, a smartphone could also serve the purpose. However, the phone might be convenient for apps, but not for carrying out lengthy assignments or research. Now again, while 24% Indians own a smartphone, I repeat, 24% Indians own a smartphone, only 11% of households possess any type of computer, which could include desktop, laptops, notebooks, netbooks, palm tops, or even tablets. Even the penetration of digital technologies in India has been haphazard. According to the 2017-18 National Sample Survey Report on Education, only 24% of Indian households have an internet facility. I repeat, according to the 2017-18 National Sample Survey Report on Education, only 24% of Indian households have an internet facility. Why? 66% of Indian population lives in villages, only a little over 15% of rural households have access to internet services. For urban households, the proportion is 42%. I would like to repeat these statistics once more so that you can understand where we are as far as the digital situation, digital technologies and internet connectivity is concerned. Only 24% of Indian households have an internet facility, while 66% of Indian population lives in villages. Only a little over 15% of rural households have access to internet services. For urban households, the proportion is 42%. In fact, only 8% of all households with members aged between 5 and 24 have both a computer and an internet connection. It is also useful to note that as per the National Sample Survey definition, a household with a device or internet facility does not necessarily mean that the connection and devices are owned by the household. Here I wanted to, you know, take you to today's Anandabajar Potrika. I am not sure how many of you have got the opportunity or time to go through the first page of Anandabajar. It says, Akkhur Gyan Bedeche Prosne Online Path. So where we have only 8% people in India, where we have the connection or having a computer in their household, there we need to think about the introduction of online teaching and research, how it would be possible and what would be the modus operandi to, you know, take it forward. Digital divide, which is really a big concern in Indian scenario. The digital divide is evident across class, gender, religion, or place of residence. Among the poorest 20% households, I say again, among the poorest 20% households, only 2.7% have access to a computer and 8.9% to internet facilities. Only 2.7% have access to a computer and 8.9% to internet facilities. In case of the top 20% households, the proportion are 27.6% and 50.5%. There we are. This is the scenario of internet connectivity and computer availability in the poor as well as the people who are living on the top of the society. Then comes gender divide. The gender divide in internet usage is also struck. As per the Internet and Mobile Association of India report, in 2019, while 67% men had access to internet, this figure was only 33% for women. The disparity is more prominent in rural India, where the figures are 72% and 28% for men and women respectively. So, digital divide is very evident in gender also. So these are all the digital things that I was talking about. Apart from access, digital education also requires regular and predictable internet connectivity. You all are aware, or you are all are used to see the connectivity problem when we are, you know, residing in a city. But think about the situation in rural India, a village, where getting a connection is like getting something very big. For example, I was going through an article which I mention everywhere nowadays, that a person who was working in an organization here was forced to go to his village due to shutdown. So the organization in Kolkata decided to continue their teaching or coaching courses on WBCS, what they were doing when it was normal. So the organization contacted the person in East Medinipur to join the course as a teacher. It was a big problem for him to get internet connectivity. He tried everywhere. Finally, the elder of the village told him to climb the neem tree where he might get the connectivity. So he tried that, and fortunately he could get the connectivity at the top of the neem tree, and he started taking his classes over there, making a platform, small platform where he used to sit from morning till evening to take the classes for WB West Bengal civil service examinations aspirants. So that is the scenario of, you know, getting internet connectivity in rural Bengal or rural India. To support online work from home during this lockdown period, telecom operators and broadband service providers like Vodafone, Jio and BSNL are offering facilities like additional data and free internet to their subscribers. But the question is, would these offers really ensure a sound transition of online classes to students across the country? That we need to think. Even if the basic infrastructure was in place, we wish we had, a whole set of additional gaps are also evident. Merely moving traditional classrooms to online teaching would not mean effective remote learning. One-to-one interactions among peers and teachers are very important for learning. For example, now I am talking to you, I cannot see your face, I cannot see your body language. So that is the problem teachers are also facing when they are trying to teach to their students. They are used to see their students sitting in front of them. They could see their pulse, how they are taking the class. They could see their faces, which is very important. One-to-one interactions, which is not possible when we are taking the classes online on a digital platform, how students learn and communicate with others is largely dependent on the readiness of both teachers and students to accept digital learning. In the case of distance education, the onus of learning is more on students, and the students for that has to be more disciplined. There are challenges for teachers too. Not only are many of them tech savvy, a large number of teachers have never used an online environment to teach. And that is true. We never had to do this. So we are not used to teach our students online. We are forced to teach because the situation made us to teach online. So a large number of teachers have never used an online environment to teach in India, at least I know. Teaching a course online ideally requires lots of preparation, such as designing a lesson plan and preparing teaching materials such as audio and video contents. This has posed new challenges for many teachers. Learning demands a conducive environment for study. However, not all students have a quiet space for learning at home. While 37% of households in India have one dwelling room, it would be a luxury for many to attend lectures in an undisturbed environment. Having online classes on a regular basis has a cost implication too, as students have to bear the cost of internet services. There is no communication yet from government on whether it is going to reimburse students or will provide free or subsidized data packs. In the current situation, many students, especially those whose families have lost income as a result of a lockdown related job loss, will not be able to afford this cost of internet connectivity. So when we are thinking about online teaching and learning, we need to consider all these infrastructural constraints, especially when we are thinking to teach 3.74 crores of students of higher education across India, which is really a big job when we do not have the actual infrastructure to provide online teaching and learning to our students and the teachers. And we are considering the number, which is really big. Only in higher education, it is 3.7 crore of students. That is not included the students of schools, those who are doing school education. So there we have to, of course, think. However, in spite of all these infrastructural disadvantages, we are optimistic. Professor Mukhopadhyay might have thought by now that Sushanto is talking only about negative things, only about infrastructure. He is not thinking the situation. He is not thinking the proliferation of information resources all over the world and how information resources is changing the scenario of hard copies or print copies of materials. I am certainly thinking about, you know, the proliferation of information resources all over the world and how e-resources is taking place of print media, how e-resources is changing the way we used to work in our day-to-day work, and how e-resources is changing the style of working all over the world. But I wanted to highlight the infrastructure that we have in India, and we are thinking e-resources, and we have to promote e-resources for the benefit of the education. But when we think about the promotion of e-resources, we need to think about the infrastructure. That was my main intention, to highlight the infrastructure where we are, including the facility of electricity, computers, and other electronic resources. But I am also optimistic. In spite of all these, as I said, infrastructural disadvantages, we are optimistic and would like to take this initiative forward. There is no other option but to take e-resources, e-learning forward, because that is the that is the thing nowadays. That is the thing, that is the word, that is the initiative that we need to consider in today's society. Now, as I said, that there are a lot of things we need to think about before we go for e-resources. E-resources have a lot of advantages also. Lot of advantages. The main advantage of e-learning is that it can be done anywhere and at any time. E-resources, e-learning can be done anywhere and at any time. It requires very limited physical space. And the feasibility in full content search is always possible. Thus, the e-resources have significant roles to play in teaching and learning process. And hence, it is the high time for the teachers to get an awareness of these resources for their future academic growth. As I said earlier, that we never thought about e-resources, seriously. We all will agree that we never thought seriously about e-resources, but COVID-19 made us thought about e-resources. If I give you an example, in an organization where I used to work, we had very important e-resource contents in our library, which includes LexisNexis or ProQuest, data like this, databases like this. But when we used to see the usage at the end of the year, because these databases are very costly, as mentioned by my previous speaker, my friend, Professor Mukhopadhyay, really databases are very costly. It was very disheartening that we used to see only 2% users. All of our Eastern India used our databases, for which we paid a huge amount to subscribe or to renewal for these databases. So it was not used to be used properly before the COVID-19. So COVID-19 made us think the use of e-resources, and thus we need to learn the usage of e-resources. The sources of e-resources is very important. These are all the things that we need to learn now. In last 40 years or so, the world has transformed into something which could never have been imagined by any one of us. The progress in computers and communication technology has made a revolution in information explosions. As a result, we have much more information than we can handle. Now, to give you a burning example, if you see the information that we get regularly on different modes about COVID-19. Say, for example, the information we get about West Bengal, the situation of COVID-19 in West Bengal is so much that we do not know how to handle this situation, how to handle this information, whether which information has to be taken as true, which is not, how to filter this information. So this has affected our attention span, our ability to actually absorb and analyze the right information that we want, right? So the proliferation of information or information explosions has made us, you know, think about the concept of right information and wrong information, and which one has to be taken, which one we should not take, which we should be filtering. So that is the thing we are facing. This is not today. This is for last 40 years, last four decades. This is happening gradually, but the explosion has come now in a very big way. Readers get information, but not retainable knowledge. We are really getting a lot of information. For example, if you see the messages you get in your different forms of information sources, the Facebook or other places where you get information every day, there also you need to filter the information and has to take the right information for the use of your day-to-day purpose. This includes Facebook, Twitter, whatnot, web chat, and other sources also. But since we are not the information specialists, those who are in teaching job, since we haven't taught how to filter the right information and how to get the right information from a source of different kind of information, there it comes the role of the librarians. As Professor Mukhopadhyay was mentioning, that role of the librarians for synthesizing, for taking the right information and providing the right information to the teachers and the students by compiling right information tools during the process of teaching and learning. This is very important for the librarian to provide to our teachers. So the librarian has to play a big role in today's society to filter information and to provide the right information for teaching and research. Here, I have compiled a list of e-resources. As I was telling, the role of the librarian to compile good information, right information, which will be readily available for the professors or for the teachers or for the students. That is the duty of the librarian or information professor, professionals or information officers. I have compiled a list of e-resources that are freely available and covers most of the important and useful resources of all the disciplines for the teachers and learners. So that I would like to show you. And I have made a distinct classification of these information tools so that you can get it easily. I have given the URLs also so that you can go there and find this information easily to for your work purpose. Can I request? It is already there, I can see. So can you see the screen?
Yes, we can see.
Can you see that?
Yes, yeah. We can see.
So, MHRD initiatives. Raj, can you make it bigger a bit?
Dr. Banerjee, please unmute.
Yeah, so see how much training we need, because I took 2-3 times to I made the mistake of unmuting the system at least 2 times now. So I have classified the information. Mainly these all are the information that you find what Indian government MHRD has taken the initiative for the teachers and the students in different segments. First thing is SWAM, this facilitated hosting of all the courses taught in academics from class 9 till postgraduate. So SWAM is giving that, can be accessed by anyone at any place. Then comes UGC MOOCs. This is very important. You have now, I know the CAS based education system, professors has to follow CAS, CAS it says. So MOOCs has lot of points or marks, I don't know what you say. If you develop contents or if you conduct MOOCs, there are numbers or points for your career development. So MOOCs is this is being developed by UGC. There are 128 PG courses and 240 UG courses, which you can see in MOOCs, developed by MOOCs. EPG Pathshala, this is another important content by MHRD, and this is managed actually by InfliNet, Indian Library and Information Network. So here also you can get quality courses for almost all the disciplines. Swayam Prabha, it is again a group of 32 DTH channels, which is being played throughout the day 24/7. You can see these channels. Then comes Shodh Ganga. Shodh Ganga is, as already mentioned by Professor Mukherjee, that here you can submit your thesis online, and it is a repository of thesis, online thesis, which is being kept in Shodh Ganga. Next slide. Consortium for Educational Communication, that is CES. CES CES regulatory organizes various capacity building programs. This is the organization which organizes various capacity building programs, trainings and workshops. It also organizes annual educational video competition to encourage and recognize excellence in educational video program, produces in different media centers. Then comes National Digital Library. This is the URL I would request you all to go and see. This is very important URL. This is the URL which was a big initiative by MHRD Government of India. NDL is digitized to provide support for all academic levels, including researchers and lifelong learners. It provides support to all disciplines, all popular forms of access devices, and differently aided learners. It is for all. National Digital Library, NDL is for all courses, all subjects, all devices, and all the people. Then comes Vidwan. It is again an initiative by MHRD. Vidwan is the database where you can get experts of different fields of the different subjects all over India in different universities. So this is very important site for you. If you want to organize a program, say you are organizing a program today, like that, when you organize programs, whether it is a physical program or online program, you can go to this site Vidwan and can choose your expert all across India and can use them for your programs. Next slide, please. Some important publishing houses. It is already discussed by Partho, that important publishing houses what we have. It is Taylor and Francis is one of the most important publishing house that provides databases. One of the world's largest publishing open access sources. They publish over 180 high quality full open access journals ranging across disciplines and subjects. Now, Taylor and Francis, it is when you go to subscribe, it is really very, very costly product. Universities like ours, we are not even in a position now to subscribe this kind of databases because it is very costly. So we would always look for open sources. And since they have 180 high quality open sources, then we will be going for those sources, which ranging from all from science to humanities everywhere. Elsevier, already mentioned by Professor Mukhopadhyay, specializes in science, technical, and medical content. It publishes more than 5 lakh articles annually in 2,500 journals. Its archives contain over 17 million documents and 40,000 ebooks. Total yearly downloads amount to more than 1 billion. So that is Elsevier. Again, it is a very costly database. You know, small colleges or universities getting fund for this kind of database, it is difficult. But what we consider the local, that is open sources, and we plan to use whatever open sources we can get from Elsevier. Wiley, another important database, you all know Wiley. Wiley Open Access publishes authoritative, peer-reviewed open access journals across many research disciplines. So again, all these three publishers getting their publishing sources or databases is very difficult, it's very costly, but we can use their open resources which are available free of cost. All these URLs you can get afterwards if you like. So this is a compilation of all these resources. Next, Dr. Wille, Springer, you know, again another costly database, offers researchers from all areas of science, technology, medicine, the humanities and social sciences a place to publish open access in journals. You can publish also in Springer. Science Open offers content hosting, content building and marketing services for the publishers. Then Science Direct, you can browse 4,288 journals and 30,568 books in Science Direct. There are open access, so you can get it free from Science Direct. Then OL Open Access Library, free access to 44,086,359 academic articles. So OAL already mentioned by again Professor Mukherjee. This is one of the biggest information sources, largest information sources, and lot of articles on different subjects you can get from here. JSTOR, you all are familiar with this, an important platform for open access books and journals. If we have money, then we can subscribe all these, you know, resources. Question is money. If you have fund, enough fund, then you can subscribe all this. But if money is the constraint, then we need to think about open resources which are being provided by these publishers free of cost for the institutions who cannot subscribe or not have the fund to subscribe these resources. Oxford Academics, another important platform, a platform to facilitate the widest possible dissemination of high quality research work. So there also you can go and find out lot of resources open. This is also open and free. But again, as I mentioned here, all these publishers or their databases are costly databases, very costly databases. Institutions like IIT, IIM, ISI, they can subscribe. They have a lot of money. But government-aided colleges or universities, it is not that easy that we get funding so much that we can subscribe all these resources. Though as a librarian, I'll be really happy to have all of these resources, databases in our library, but fund is a constraint. So what we have to do? We have to compile resources from different sources and give it to our faculty members so that they can go here at least and find out the open sources so that they can fulfill their requirements through open sources as much as they can. So next, other important resources, Directory of Open Access Journal, DOAJ, already described, an online directory that indexes and provides access to high quality open access peer reviewed journals. So you can go here also. This is very important source for getting information on different subjects. Agricultural Science and Technology, AGRIS. AGRIS is one of the world's leading public information service that offers 11,934,258 bibliographical records. It also provides full text links to about 3 million of its records. So here you can have access. That is, AGRIS is one of the most important databases where the important for those who are doing agricultural research and all, they can have access to this. Then DOAB, Directory of Open Access Books, already mentioned in by my previous speaker, an online directory that indexes and provides access to high quality peer reviewed open access books. So DOAJ, and I will suggest you to go for DOAJ and DOAB for open access journals and open access books. URLs you can get, as I compile, I will be happy to share this URLs with you. Next, we have other important open resources. National Program on Technology Enhanced Learning, NPTEL. Some of you will be familiar with this, an initiative by 7 IITs, IIT Mumbai, Delhi, Guwahati, Kanpur, Kharagpur, Madras, and Roorkee, and IISc for creating course content in engineering and science. They are doing this. NPTEL, on initiative of premier institutions, as I told, as already mentioned to you, that IITs and IISc Bangalore, they are creating course content for science and engineering students, and it is free of cost. Open access thesis and dissertations, already mentioned, a repository of open access thesis and dissertations published around the world. OATD currently indexes 5,153,410 theses and dissertations. So here you can have free access. And when you are doing your research, you can see what all you have done on your particular field going through this open source. Then Open Knowledge Repository, World Bank. This is World Bank's creation. They have given the database or their work, what they have done, the research for the public to view. And this is again open access. You can go and see their work, what they are doing, what they have done, what World Bank have done in their research work. Then Legal Information Institute of India, LII of India. LII of India is an international standard. Free access, comprehensive online collection of Indian legal information. This is really important nowadays. Lot of information, legal information are available, and people are asking, people are searching this information for their research and related activities. Then OAPEN Foundation, OAPEN promotes and supports the transition to open access for academic books. So if you have a book which is hard copy, you can always approach to OAPEN for converting into e-content. Next. Project Gutenberg or PubMed Central. PubMed Central, is a free full text archive of biomedical and life science journals. Those who are doing medicine and doing their research on life science, PubMed is very important and would be useful for them. It is, again, you can have open access. Lot of journals are free. You can go here for your research purpose. Project Gutenberg, name suggests, an online library of free ebooks. Project Gutenberg was the first provider of free electronic books. They were the first to provide free electronic books. ILO stat is the global reference for international labor statistics, providing a comprehensive database and resources for producing labor statistics. This is important all over the world. Labor statistics is really important for a different decision-making organization of the country. So ILO stat is another important database if you are working on labor-related issues. Public book database. You can download books, journals, articles, etc. from the public books database. because of COVID-19. Till COVID-19, this will be free. I don't know after once it goes, whether it will be free or not. Now, library portal. National Library has launched an integrated search portal for open access educational resources to be used by the citizens of India during lockdown period. This is again, as I mentioned, for public book database. National Library portal also is given during the lockdown period. Then coming to Bengal, I thought of giving you some databases about West Bengal also. So West Bengal Public Library Network, any user can have access to this network at any time with the help of a computer terminal. This is the initiative of Library and Information Science Department and Mass Education Department of Government of West Bengal. You can have access to books and other resources anytime, anywhere. You should have a device to have access to this database. Digital Depository of West Bengal Public Library. You can find copyright-free rare books which are under the custody of various libraries of West Bengal, India. So, a lot of libraries are having rare books. This is the compilation of those rare books which are available in different libraries in West Bengal. You can have access to this through this database to those books. Then come indianjournals.com, provides a vast collection of interdisciplinary Indian journals and research publications. Then comes online books page. It lists freely accessible archives of magazines, journals, newspapers, and other publications. So you can have the access to newspaper and as well as journals and books, everything over here. Last one. Bentham opens, already discussed by Professor Mukhopadhyay. Spoken tutorial. This is a good open source. This platform provides the opportunity to learn various free and open software. Anybody with a computer can learn from any place at any time and in a language of their choice. There is the importance of this portal. You can learn of your own language. You do not have to learn only through English. So any language, it is possible. So spoken tutorial, again, I will suggest that if anyone wants to learn free and open source softwares, then this is the place they have to go. So with this, I would like to conclude my presentation. But again, I will say that I started with people may think that a negative note, but we need to think that when we are thinking about open resources, we need to have really the infrastructure, which is really important. Without infrastructure, we cannot go for open resources. We need to have training. Say the students were
if they do not have training, if they do not have proper resources, how can you get in touch with the students? So I wanted to give you the reality of the infrastructure where we stand, as well as the resources which you can use for your research and making your reading materials for the students. I know the teachers are doing their best I know so many professors and teachers, those who are doing their level best to reach to their students, communicate to their students. What they are doing, I know that they are recording their teaching materials and sending it to the students through through different modes. Could be Facebook and other mode messages and web and other modes whatever we have. So in addition to that, they are talking to them through phone also, so that they can be communicated. They think that they are in touch, though they cannot see them personally in the classroom, and they cannot meet them, talk to them personally face to face. Our teachers are trying their level best, and even they are conducting examinations also. It is mandatory now to have examinations in final years. So our teachers, they are conducting the examinations, but there also we have some problems. So some colleges or universities, they have decided that the questions will be given to them online, but the students will have the option to write on paper and submit those papers or copies to the respective colleges and universities and take their exams. So that way it is going now. I look forward to have a real ground, a real digital platform, or all the infrastructure including electricity, internet, computer connectivity, computer, laptop, and other things. India with digital resources, what China has now, they are really ready with all their equipments and other required materials. So we would really look forward for that, and we would see that India goes for digital resources as far as possible, as fast as possible. With these few words, I would like to conclude my presentation, and I am thankful to my previous speaker, Professor Parthapati Mukhopadhyay, who has really given a very good presentation about the key contents. Thank you very much for your patience and hearing me for such a long time.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your insights and experiences with us. We are extremely delighted to have you with us, and thanks a lot for allotting time for us in spite of your hectic schedule. There are several question answers both for you and Dr. Parthasarathi Mukhopadhyay. Shall I continue, sir?
Yes, please.
Okay. The first question is, how one can access National Library? What are the steps required to follow in case of National Digital Library?
National Digital Library, you have to go to the URL, NDL. It is very easy. You type NDL in Google Chrome, and there you will get the total information. So go to their URL first and get the information.
Okay. The next one is, can I get video lectures from the virtual from the National Digital Library?
Yes, you can.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can I download ebooks from the NDL?
Downloading ebooks is also possible.
Okay. Okay. Could you know something about sites where we can access digital books?
Online access DB that I already mentioned, OADB. There you can go and can get all digital books. Even digital books, you can get NDL also. NDL also you can get, but OADB is one of the most important sources for downloading digital books. It is a peer-reviewed digital books.
Okay. The next one is NDL free access resource?
Yeah, it is free. Absolutely free.
Okay. So there are some questions for Dr. Mukhopadhyay. Would you like to answer those?
Dr. Mukhopadhyay is not there.
No, he has to leave because due to some another assignments.
Okay, let me see what are the questions.
Okay.
Of course, I'll do that.
One question is the development of Moodle is a hectic one?
Is the?
Development of Moodle is a hectic one?
No, it is not a hectic one. You should have some patience and develop it. It is not that that hard.
Okay. The next one is, what are the challenging issues on Research 2.0 and future of information literacy programs, particularly in Indian scenario?
See, as I told you already, there are challenges. There are challenges. Research 2.0, it is again technology based research. So you need to have the proper infrastructure. As I mentioned, lot of deficiencies we are still facing in India. So you need to have internet connectivity, you need to have a computer, and you need to have proper reliable internet connectivity for this program. So which is not there in India yet. So we are looking forward, as I said in my conclusion, that we are looking forward to have this digital infrastructure properly introduced in India, so that 2.0 literacy can be possible and it can go to the masses.
Okay. The next question is for you, sir. What is the present scenario of information literacy program among the library professionals in the university library, especially in the West Bengal?
Information literacy program for university library, I do not know whether we have a specific program for information literacy. That depends on the librarian, actually. You need to develop yourself through different modes, different channels. For example, as I was telling you when giving the presentation, I prepared myself with all these resources, because I had to give the lecture or the presentation today. So I need to know what all are the resources that are open and that are useful for the teachers and students or the researchers who are doing research in different fields or different subject areas. So specific literacy, I don't see much, but yes, in Flipbit, they do a lot of programs from time to time for the librarians on different issues, which include even plagiarism software related issue. So you can attend those programs if your university fund permits. So there you have the opportunity to make yourself more literate about different subject areas and attend presentations, lectures, seminars of different people that will help you becoming more information literate and providing information to others.
Thank you, sir, for your enlightening lecture and addressing the queries of our participants. Now we reach towards the end of our webinar. As a convener, I would like to express my gratitude for our esteemed resource persons, our college authority, Bursar sir, IQAC madam, and our faculty members and non-teaching staff of our college, and last but not the least, our dear participants, for their best wishes and unconditional support. Now I would like to request Mrs. Piyali Das, Assistant Professor, Department of English, to give formal vote of thanks. Over to you, madam.
Thank you once again, Shuli. So we have come to the final part of today's webinar with a vote of thanks. On behalf of our college, I would like to thank both of our honored speakers, Professor Parthasarathi Mukhopadhyay and Dr. Sushanto Banerjee, for their enlightening presentation. Their deliberations on how to utilize the e-resources in the present pandemic situation have been really helpful for all of us. Next, sincere thanks to our Honorable President Sir, Sri Joydev Haldar, for constantly encouraging us for such programs. Our respected Principal Sir has also been always morally and physically supporting us. So thanks to him too. Thank you, our Bursar, Dr. Taposh Kumar Paul, for being with us in all these webinars. Our GB members are also being thanked for their support. Our IQAC coordinator, Professor Ronjini Guho, has been constantly helping us throughout all these webinars. So I thank her. Next, our librarian, Ms. Shuli Shengupto, is back with us after a long struggle with critical illness. So a special thanks to her for organizing this whole event. Our thanks also to Sri Shomoresh Pramanik, Department of Computer Science of our college, for his unending technical support. Thanks to our college colleagues for being with us. And last but not the least, thanks to all our participants and dear students who have been the backbone of this program. Thank you.
Thank you all, and we can end formally end this webinar today. And thank you to all our viewers. And another reminder to please tune in tomorrow at 11 a.m. to hear Professor Rekha Pandey, one of the doyens of Women's Studies Research in India Today, the former ex-director, Center for Women's Studies, Hyderabad University. Thank you, and see you soon again.